Welcome to the Commentaries, a podcast series from TAN in which you'll learn how to read and understand history's greatest Catholic works from today's greatest Catholic scholars. In every series of the Commentaries, your expert host will be your personal guide to not just read the book, but to live the book, shining the light of its eternal truths into our modern darkness. Visit tancommentaries.com to get your copy of the book and to subscribe for access to all the great reading plans, new episodes, bonus content, and exclusive deals for listeners of the Commentaries.
Today is day 12, and we'll be covering chapter 7, part 2, in the 10 edition of the book covering the entry into Carmel of the Little Flower. But before we jump into this timeless memoir and spiritual guide, let us begin with a short prayer composed by the Little Flower called the Holy Face. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, Amen. O adorable face of Jesus, O beauty which ravishes my heart, vouchsafe to impress on my soul thy divine likeness, so that it may not be possible for thee to look at thy spouse without beholding thyself. O my beloved, for love of thee, I am content not to see here on earth the sweetness of thy glance, nor to feel the ineffable kiss of thy sacred lips, but I beg of thee to inflame me with thy love, so that it may consume me quickly, and that soon Therese of the Holy Face may behold thy glorious face in heaven. In the name of the Father, and Son, and the Holy Ghost, Amen. A story of the soul written under obedience gained universal demand, and it looked upon the spiritual childhood. Pope Pius XI said that it brought great profit to souls because it enkindles charity. Last time we talked about her farewell to see her father in the world for the last time. And then Therese endured her first trial in Carmel as the Reverend Mother treated the child with contempt. But Therese always saw Jesus and her superiors. Today we'll be looking at the examples of St. Louis Martin Sanctity, the father of the Little Flower, and the valuable offering that St. Louis made to God. So, St. Louis Martin, when he was on the pilgrimage to Rome with his daughters, the daughters were asked to play cards and do other tomfoolery things, but they wanted to look outside the window and to see the beauty of God passing by, to see nature. And so St. Louis Martin remarked that the purpose of a pilgrimage is to pray more. And we hear these words, "But Father calmly defended us, leaving it to be understood that on a pilgrimage there ought to be a little more prayer. One of the players, forgetting the respect due to age, thoughtlessly remarked, 'It's a good thing there aren't many more Pharisees about.' And I don't know about you, but it would be very easy to react and defend oneself with that statement, ill-thought statement. But Therese said that it seemed like he took holy delight in this reprimand. Father made no reply. He even seemed to take a holy delight in the incident, and before long found an opportunity of shaking hands with the speaker, at the same time and accompanying this fine gesture with so kindly a word that it appeared as if he had not noticed the other's rudeness, or at least had forgotten all about it. How remarkable it is how the saints, since they have a constant conversation with God, nothing can take away their peace. Then we see the fraternal charity of St. Louis Martin. When Therese wrote this, mother and all who knew him vouched for the fact that he never spoke a single uncharitable word. And I was just giving spiritual direction today, and I repeated this because I read this the day before, and how I spoke to the person receiving my direction, that it's so important that someone will say that about us, never to say an uncharitable word. Then St. Louis Martin made a generous offering and acceptance of God's desire. Therese says this, his faith and generosity were equal to every trial. This is how he told a friend of his about my leaving home. Quote, Therese, my little queen entered Carmel yesterday. Only God could ask such a sacrifice, but he helps me so much that my heart is filled with joy, even in the midst of tears. So as I commented earlier in the book, life is a constant separation of ones that we love. And that just should make our desire for God grow more. Then he gave a generous offering. Such a faithful servant deserved a fitting reward for his virtue. And you remember, Mother, the reward he himself asked of God that day at visiting time when he said to us, I've just returned from Alcyon in the Church of Notre Dame. I received such great graces and consolations that I prayed, it is too much, my God. I am too happy. This is not the way to heaven. I want to suffer something for you, and I offer myself as a dot, dot, dot. The word victim died on his lips. He dared not say it in front of us, but we understood. So this begs a question, what is a victim? What is a victim's soul? I like the phrase that St. Padre Pio used. And he calls these types of souls that want to be very generous to offer to God anything. He called them victims of love. And if God ever takes the acceptance of an offering of a victim of love, he gives them many trials and sufferings. And we'll find out about this later on. And so we want to continue in that similar theme, and it's the valuable offering of St. Louis to God. And that was offering of Therese. They were arm in arm, and they made their solemn entry into heaven. So imagine this scene. You're in a beautiful oratory or a chapel of the Carmel of Lisieux. Louis completely emptied himself, and he decided after giving his last daughter to God to make a visit to the Blessed Sacrament. And this is what Therese wrote. It was his day of triumph, his last feast on earth. He had no more to offer. His whole family belonged to God. Since Celine had told him that later on she too was going to leave the world for Carmel, overjoyed, he had replied in his incomparable way, we must go at once to the Blessed Sacrament and thank our Lord for the graces he has showed upon our family and for the honor he has done us in choosing his brides from my house. For it is indeed a great honor that he should ask me for my children. If I had anything better, I would not hesitate to offer to him. So, I want to make a comment on the visit to the Blessed Sacrament. This practice is dwindling in our times. As I make comments on the story of a soul, we've had the closing of the churches and a great lockdown worldwide a few years ago. And the locking of the churches in the present era is very commonplace because people come into churches to steal things. But there are a few churches that are still open during the day. And I want to encourage all of you listeners to make visits to the Blessed Sacrament. It's great. There's a lot of places that have perpetual adoration, and people sign up for an hour or 2 hours a week. But it's also good to be spontaneous with our Lord, to know to go into a church because he's dwelling in there. He's a prisoner for us. And we have such an opportunity for him to change us completely and interiorly, and we won't even know what's happening. Ah, how I wish to see at the churches where I walk around, because I walk around and visit the Blessed Sacrament, I wish to see them filled with people, and it's not even time for Mass or a wedding or anything like a baptism, but just because they want to be with Jesus. How this world would be so different. We should follow St. Louis, who would make visits often, and look at the great fruits that he received. He became a saint, and his daughter is also a saint, and so is his wife, Zelie. Then continuing, we see the spiritual fatherly affection that the bishop had. We're living in an era that there's been a great sex scandal within the church, and it's left a very dark cloud on everybody. But there was an innocence that used to be such, where Jesus was even known to say, "Let the little children come to me." And so the bishop had a great example of this fatherly affection to the little flower. Therese writes, "The bishop came in after the ceremony and showed himself a real father, reminding me, in front of all the priests who were with him, of my visit to Bayeux and of my pilgrimage to Rome, without forgetting how I had put up my hair. Then, taking my head in his hands for a long time, he made much of me." What a pure caress this great bishop had in front of all the priests and the nuns, to see the beauty of the soul of this little girl who would become a saint. Ah, maybe we'll never experience moments like that in this world, in this valley of tears. But hopefully, readers, listeners, will be able to have these holy embraces in heaven for eternity. Then Therese gives wonderful reflections of suffering and the idea of how they will be recalled in heaven. Again, the theme continues, the value of suffering is known by the saints. She writes, "Later on in heaven, we will love to recall the dark days of exile, and indeed even now Father's 3 years of martyrdom seem to me the most desirable and fruitful years we have ever had, and I would not exchange them for the most sublime ecstasies. In face of such a priceless treasure, my heart cries out in gratitude, 'Blessed be thou, my God, for the days wherein thou hast afflicted us.'" Ah, how she touches upon, she would rather have this with our Lord to recall later on in heaven, that her father's martyrdom seemed to her to be the most desirable and fruitful years that we ever had. She then speaks very, very enlightenedly, saying this, "I would not exchange them for the most sublime ecstasy." So here we have such an important point. She is so rooted in the interior life, the three ages of the spiritual life, the purgative way, the illuminative way, and the unitive way, are better than the extraordinary phenomena that concur, like tongues and being able to read people's minds, prophecy, things like that. But I do want to make a distinction. Ecstasies do happen in the higher stages of the unitive way, but that shows a weakness of the soul, that it has to have those ecstasies, because as the soul matures and goes higher up into the spiritual espousals and then the spiritual marriage, it doesn't have to have these ecstasies because it's used to having God so filled in the soul. So she penetrates with great depths and wisdom the interior life. And that's why she's such a wonderful soul to teach the world today how important the interior life is and not the extraordinary phenomenon. Then we have an example of the acceleration of spiritual growth. Darling Mother, it was so bitter a cross, and yet how precious and sweet. Since drawing from our hearts this act of love and gratitude, we no longer walked along the way of perfection. We ran. That's just it, souls. We only have so long to live here. Every breath we take, every heartbeat, we should be accelerating towards God. He should be drawing us more quickly. So we need to dispose ourselves so that God will come down and pull us to himself, so that it's no longer us rowing the boat, but that our boat is blown by the Holy Spirit across the waves that will reach into the port of heaven. She speaks about how inordinate self-love must be purged. She wrote, "I found it hard to accept such a sacrifice at first, but before long my soul was flooded with divine light. I had been meditating on Surin's foundations of the spiritual life, and one day realized that my eagerness to take my vows was tainted with self-love." So you see, God wanted to take her so soon because she got it. She got the spiritual life at such a tender age. She was so docile, allowing God to penetrate. And she was well beyond, in the illuminative way, the second stage of the three ages when she wrote that. And of course, sometimes souls go between stages as they're progressing. So she may be going from the illuminative to the unitive way, but she's definitely not in the purgative way, because souls that are there are still trying to rid themselves of mortal sin. And as we talked about earlier, we discussed that her confessor said, he declared that he thought she never committed a mortal sin. Then we hear a good example of divine providence. As she's speaking of preparing herself to be a good bride, she said, "I set to work with renewed zeal. Since taking my habit, I had already been given abundant light on religious perfection, and especially on the vow of poverty. When I was a postulant, I loved using nice things and having everything in hand when I needed it. Jess bore that patiently. He does not like teaching us everything at once, but normally enlightens us a little more." Then we see an example of growth and humility. "At the beginning of my spiritual life, when I was between 13 and 14, I used to wonder what else there was for me to learn. It did not seem possible that I could ever understand perfection any better than I already had. I soon found, however, that the more one advances, the further off one sees the goal to be." So this is just another maxim that as we grow in the way of illumination, we're enlightened to know how little we are and how God is everything. And God once told Saint Catherine of Siena, saying, "Catherine, I am who am, and you are who are not." And so we see when infinity comes against finity, us, so God to us, there is such a chasm that it's a mysterious and it's unexplainable. Lastly, her desire to be despised grew, and then she linked it to eschatology, to the end. "My first victory was not a very big one, but it cost me a great deal. Someone or other had left a little vase on a window sill, and it was found broken. Our mistress thought it was my fault. She seemed very annoyed that I had left it there and told me to be more careful next time, adding that I had no idea at all of tidiness. Without saying a word, I kissed the ground and promised I would take more care in the future. Such little things, as I have said, cost me a great deal, because I was so lacking in virtue, and I had to remind myself that it would all be made known on the day of judgment." So you see there, little souls that want to be like the little flower, we have to remember the four last things: death, judgment, heaven, and hell. And judgment the Day of Judgment, she comes back to these four themes so often. That's why the fathers of the church said if we contemplated the four last things, we would never commit a mortal sin. And so that brings us to the end of day 12 in our study of the story of a soul. Thank you so much for listening and for joining me on your journey to grow deeper in your spiritual life. Next time, we'll be discussing chapter 8, part 1, in which the little flower recounts the holy hours that she makes and how Jesus works on souls mysteriously in them, and also how she was very prophetic, how she knew that she would go early, that she would die at a young age. Until then, God bless you.
This has been an episode of The Commentaries, a podcast brought to you by Tan. To follow the show, study more of the greatest Catholic classics, and to support The Commentaries and other great free content from Tan, visit tancommentaries.com to subscribe and use coupon code COM25 to get 25% off your next order, including The Story of a Soul and countless more spiritual works to deepen your interior life and guide you to heaven.